Certainly a pleasure to be here this morning and to spend the next couple of hours with you talking about something that's near and dear to my heart, harassment and violence in the workplace. This morning we're going to be going through your policy as well as breaking the presentation into two parts. First part of the presentation is going to be workplace harassment. And when we talk about workplace harassment, we're going to be talking about, well, why are we doing this? What are the legislative requirements? What does the law require of the employer? And what does the law require of you as employees and volunteers? Part two of the presentation, we're going to be talking about workplace violence. And what exactly is that? That's fairly new legislation in Ontario. And we're going to talk about what was called Bill 168, but which is now part of the Occupational Health and Safety Act in Ontario. And the Occupational Health and Safety Act was changed in Ontario after some pretty high profile incidents in workplaces. Many of you know about the OC Transpo incident here in Ottawa, where people died as a result of a co-worker coming to work with a gun. We also had a very serious situation in a hospital in Windsor where a young nurse was gunned down by a physician working at the hospital as well. As a consequence of that, we looked at it and the Ontario government said we need to make changes, we need to strengthen the laws, and that's why we're doing what I refer to as Bill 168, training violence in the workplace training, because that is now part of the legislation and a requirement for every employer. And then we're going to look at your policy. And again, the policy is part of the government's plan to ensure that workers are safe at work, that they have a means for raising complaints, investigating those complaints, making sure that employers have emergency measures in place. We'll just do a little quiz, a little show of hands here. True and false. First one, an employee who repeatedly asks for a date with another employee after being told no could be committing harassing behavior. How many think that that's true? How many think that that's false? I'm not sure if the lady in the back was true or false. Okay, you're correct. It is true. And the repeated behavior is the issue. It's not harassment if you asked a coworker to go for lunch with you, if you asked a coworker to go out on a date for you with you. If you ask and they say no and then you continue to ask them, that's when you're crossing the line into the harassing behavior. Next. To determine whether someone is easily offended, it's best to tell them a racially offensive joke and watch for the reaction. True? How many say that's true? All right, an enlightened group. Clearly that's false. Telling offensive jokes is not acceptable in the workplace on anyone's standards. Okay, next. Supervisors are required by law to address concerns of harassment or discrimination. Is that true or false? Correct. Everyone got it. Ignoring someone you pass in the corridor is disrespectful behavior. It's rude. It may be disrespectful in some circumstances. It may be rude in some circumstances. I mean, you may be reading a document while you're walking down the hall. You may be thinking about something else. But as the woman in the front row said, if in fact you say hello to every single other person, hi, Jane, Mary, and John, and you don't say hi to Liz, who's standing beside them, it's rude. It's disrespectful. Is it harassment? Not necessarily. Okay. What's the most important factor, do you think, in job satisfaction? Is it, how many think it's salary? Show of hands. How much we're paid? So nobody thinks salary is the most important. So salary, nobody. Benefits, anybody? Is that the most important thing? But it is important, yes. What about job security? Yes. Believe it or not, the most important factor in job satisfaction, this has been studied not by the likes of me, but by psychologists at universities getting paid too much, respect. Respect is the most important factor in how individuals view the workplace and their happiness at their workplace. So if you work in a respectful environment, and develop a culture of respect in your workplace, you're more likely to have happy staff, you're more likely to have people that show up for work every day, you're more productive, more efficient, And what is respect? It's really what you learned in kindergarten. It's treat people the way you want to be treated. Play nice in the sandbox. Don't exclude. You know, it's very basic, but if we can all remember, you know, that respect is what this is all about. It's not just what does the law say and, you know, have I been discriminated against and have I been harassed? We're trying to take it to another level. We're trying to take it to the level of, yeah, that's what the law says, but really what we want is a respectful workplace where people treat each other with respect the way they would want to be treated themselves. So respect for what? We're talking about respect for people's time. If you're a manager, don't call a meeting at 3:45 on a Friday afternoon of a long weekend. Nobody wants to be there. That's disrespectful, especially if work's over at 4. Respectful of people's time. If you know someone has childcare arrangements and they have to pick up their child by 5:30, otherwise they're spending $10 a minute, don't ask them every night to work beyond the time that they have to leave. There are emergencies, there are situations where that will happen, and that's expected. But be respectful of people's time. Be respectful of people's privacy. Jane's gone on holidays, and you're asked to pick up the slack in her area. Don't go through her desk. Don't go through her personal belongings. Don't go through her personal email. Don't go through the photos of her vacation to Myrtle Beach last summer on her computer. So be respectful of people's privacy. Take the hint. If you come in and you're one of those people that says, hey, how was your weekend? And did you have a good time? What did you do? And you're being shut down and you're being, oh, yeah, it was very nice. Thanks. Not everybody wants to share their personal life with those that they work with. So be respectful of that and be respectful of different cultures, different religions, and the fact that, you know, may not, privacy may be a different standard. Be respectful of people's property, obviously, if they bring their things to work. Don't steal them. Don't take their Tupperware from the fridge. Don't steal their ketchup. So be respectful of people's property and be respectful of people's opinions. Everyone is entitled to an opinion. Allow opinions to be expressed at appropriate times and in appropriate manners. And don't be dismissive of individuals. Okay, so where we're expected to be respectful? We're expected to be respectful everywhere. At the office, if you're at a conference, if you're at a seminar, if you're at the office Christmas party, I don't know if you have any other office social functions outside of the office or in the office, but basically anything that is office related. You're expected to be respectful when using your computer, when using the email system, when using the telephone. Be respectful to individuals when you're talking to them on the phone or by email. So what are the disrespectful behaviors? What are we trying to avoid? Bullying, harassing people on the basis of their age, their sex, their sexual orientation, their race, their religion, the color of their skin. We want to avoid threatening behaviors. We want to avoid violent behaviors. There's no need to be throwing things in the office, to be slamming doors, to be slamming your fist down on the desk, yelling, raising your voice in anger, using foul language. These are things that are just completely unacceptable for the modern workplace. We expect people not to be rude. We expect you not to use profanity in the workplace. And you may think, oh, well, I'm just talking to my friends and it's okay if I do this, but you never really know whether your coworkers are offended by your behavior. I remember once doing a harassment training. I did a ton of harassment training seminars for Nordion over there, just down the road years ago. And I remember one of the managers coming up to me after one of my sessions, and he said, I'm so glad you gave that example about the women teasing the guy in the office who was wearing shorts, and they were chatting about his sexy legs. Oh, nice legs in those shorts. And he said, because that happened to me. And he said, I felt so uncomfortable. And he said, I just, you know, I never wore shorts again. And he said, I really felt uncomfortable in the workplace. Another woman came up to me after one of those seminars and said to me, I'm really glad you gave that example about respecting people's privacy and respecting people's space. She said, when I was pregnant, she said, everyone thought that they could come and touch my stomach. And she said, I was so embarrassed. And I'm like, you know, I wasn't one of those pregnant women that was like, oh, yay, this is the best thing that ever happened to me. Everybody should come and touch my stomach, feel the baby move, blah, blah, blah. And she said, I suddenly had strange men coming up and women, and they're touching my stomach, and I just felt really uncomfortable. So again, be respectful. Gossiping, spreading rumors, that's a bad one. You know, it really is hurtful, and you know, we really need to be respectful of people at the workplace. If you're gossiping and spreading rumors, it creates a poisoned work environment. Individuals who are bullied in that way at work don't come to work. They spend more time on sick leave, and they eventually leave because they can't take that type of behavior in the workplace, and they move on to somewhere else where they're not going to be treated that way. Routinely interrupting other people's conversations, making a mockery of your colleagues, any of those rude behaviors we're going to avoid. Showing a lack of appreciation as a supervisor, team lead, manager, or even just coworkers. When you help each other out, say thank you. You know, don't forget our common courtesies. Being too loud, here's one, especially in an open office environment. We get lots of complaints about coworkers who are in an open office environment, and for some reason, they need to yell when they're on the telephone, or they need to have conversations about their personal life standing in a cubicle where everybody else can overhear them. Leave those things to the lunch hour. You know, sit in the lunchroom and have a good gab and laugh and do those sorts of things. But be respectful of the people around you. If you're in an open office environment, don't put your speakerphone on and leave your door open, for example. Not responding to voicemails and emails. If you get a voicemail or an email and you do not respond to it or acknowledge it, and it is something that typically should be acknowledged, that's rude and disrespectful. So let's think about that. Always being late for meetings. I was really impressed. Everybody came on time, and that's rare. So obviously you have some sort of corporate culture where people actually respect each other's time and do show up for meetings on time. Inappropriate business appearance. The office is not the beach. The office is not a bar. Flip-flops and miniskirts and, you know, your swimwear is probably not appropriate for the office. Okay, so let's see what the law in Ontario says with respect to harassment and discrimination. There's two key pieces of legislation that you need to know about: the Ontario Human Rights Code and the Occupational Health and Safety Act. And these two pieces of legislation together form the basis of our harassment and discrimination laws in Ontario. What is harassment? Well, the Ontario code and the case law defines it as a course, so that's a pattern, of comments or actions that are known, so you knew, or you ought reasonably to have known to be unwelcome. So offensive behavior that any reasonable person would have known or should have known would be unwelcome is harassment. The classic definition of harassment is a pattern, a course of conduct. That does not mean that you can't have a single incident of harassment. For example, if somebody told you a really bad joke, or if they touched you inappropriately or something like that, that obviously is harassing behavior. It also might be assault and criminal conduct and things like that. But your policy goes beyond the bare minimums, and it would apply to a single isolated incident as well. The Human Rights Code says you can't discriminate against your employees in their employment or your volunteers on the basis of a number of enumerated grounds. And the grounds are specifically set out. For example, race, ancestry, place of origin, color of your skin, ethnic origin, citizenship, creed, sex, sexual gender expression is one of the new ones. Age. It used to be that you could distinguish by mandatory retirement at age 65, but now Ontario has done away with mandatory retirement. So basically, you can't discriminate against somebody on the basis of their age, even if they're 65. Record of offenses, your marital status, family status, meaning being in a parent-child relationship, and disability. And disability or handicap is really either a mental or a physical illness that is quite pervasive and that, you know, would hamper normal life functioning. So those are the grounds that the Ontario Human Rights Code says you can't discriminate, harass, on any of these grounds. Again, workplace harassment under the Occupational Health and Safety Act in Ontario, the second piece of legislation, says that workplace harassment is engaging in a course of vexatious comment or conduct that is known or ought reasonably be known to be unwelcome. Unlike the Ontario Human Rights Code, it is not restricted to the prohibited grounds that last slide that I showed you that had all of the prohibited grounds. So it's a much broader definition and includes things like bullying, which is not covered under the Ontario Human Rights Code. Does that make sense to everybody? So if you were ever going to complain or file a complaint under the Ontario Human Rights Code, you have to get yourself within one of those heads of discrimination that we showed you on that last slide. Whereas under the new provisions under the Occupational Health and Safety Act, that's not the case. It's a broader definition of harassment. So basic principles under the law, everyone's entitled to come to work and to work in a workplace free from harassment. And it doesn't just include this office, it includes everywhere. Social functions, work-related travel, conferences, training sessions, off-site meetings if you're traveling with coworkers, all of your computer, email, telephone. And just to give you an example of how the law does take this seriously and any even sort of off-duty situations might result in a finding of harassment. There was a case a few years back with Simpsons versus the Consumers Association of Canada. And this was an Ontario Court of Appeal decision. And Mr. Simpson was the executive director of the Consumers Association of Canada. And he didn't have very good judgment. And he took a number of employees to his cottage and fed them a whole lot of alcohol. And then there was some nonsense that happened in his hot tub. And he was eventually fired for sexually harassing young female staff. And, you know, sometimes the courts are slow to catch on. And at trial, when he claimed wrongful dismissal, the trial judge said, "Oh, poor Mr. Simpson, he should have never been fired for cause for that type of behavior." And they awarded him 12 months damages in lieu of notice, plus another 6 months because he thought the Consumers Association had acted so miserably towards Mr. Simpson. So a total of 18 months. The Consumers Association appealed that decision, and thankfully the Court of Appeal, in their wisdom, overturned that 18-month damage award. Mr. Simpson was left with zero damages. They did find that there was just cause for the dismissal, even though the alleged behavior had taken place not on company time, not at a company facility, and in fact was at this executive director's personal cottage on a weekend. But again, the connection to the workplace was significant enough that he was held liable for his actions. Okay, so what is harassment? It can include, it's on a scale, let's face it. Harassment is on a scale. You've got, you know, something as minor as perhaps somebody putting a pin up in their locker, or sending around a lewd joke, or a racist, making a racist comment, to more physical, maybe, you know, touching, that sort of thing, psychological, and it can be, you know, any form, sexual, racial, personal harassment, being disrespectful, being rude, abuse of authority, which we are going to talk about, and that relates to people who have authority over others in the workplace, meaning team leads, supervisors, managers, that sort of thing. And we know that it can happen over email and your company computer. And there's been a lot of cases. I have to tell you, as an employment law lawyer, I probably see at least one case a month where you've got individuals abusing the company computer and either, you know, downloading porn at work. And that includes both men and women. I've had both cases, just so the men in the office don't feel like I'm targeting you. There's also been situations where individuals have posted comments on Facebook and other forms of social media about their employer, negative disparaging comments about their employer, about their coworkers. We've had death threats against coworkers on social media. And again, the law extends to those situations. And you've got to be very, very careful about what you put on social media, because the employer can find out about it and can certainly take steps to discipline people. In fact, terminate if they're saying things that are considered to be serious. Employees have an obligation, a duty of loyalty to their employer, and a duty of confidentiality. And if you breach that, you can be subject to disciplinary action up to and including dismissal. And I've had those situations, and I say it because I think a lot of, you know, certainly a lot of younger people in the workplace don't realize that this is, in fact, an extension if you're saying things about your employer on these social media sites, that it could be considered harassing behavior. And if you're harassing coworkers on those social media sites and it affects their ability to come to work and to feel comfortable here, then the employer can rightfully take action. And there has been all kinds of case law to support that. Okay, so let's unbundle this. Okay, so we know that harassment is something that is known or ought to be known to be harassing, meaning there doesn't have to be an intent to harass. So if you say something like, well, yeah, I told that joke, but I didn't, it was a joke. I didn't mean to harass anybody. I didn't mean to offend anybody. It doesn't matter. The fact that it is offensive is good enough to meet the test. And the question is known or ought to be known. What does that mean? Ought to be known. Well, the test is, would a reasonable person hearing this same situation be offended? So it's the reasonable person test. Okay. The comment or conduct must be unwelcome. What does that mean? Does the complainant consider the conduct or comment to constitute harassment? That's basically the second part of the test. That's a very easy part to meet. Obviously, they do if they've complained. Okay, so statements such as, I didn't mean anything by it, I was just joking, oh, he can't take a joke or she can't take a joke, are not excuses and they're not defenses to a claim of harassment or discrimination. Actual intent, I didn't mean to do it, I did mean to do it, is irrelevant. What is relevant is the impact of that behavior on the person that was subjected to it. So now I want to talk about sexual harassment, because unfortunately, this is probably one of the most serious forms of harassment and the one that we see most often in the workplace. What is sexual harassment? Basically, it's unwelcome conduct or comment of a sexual nature. And it may create what's called a poisoned work environment. A poisoned work environment is a work environment where people don't feel comfortable coming to work because they're being subjected to perhaps innuendo, lewd remarks, leering, those sorts of things. And it's conduct of a sexual nature. It can also include what we call the quid pro quo theory of harassment, which is basically sexual solicitation by a person in a position of power. And so if you're in a position of power, you are going to be held to a higher standard as a supervisor or manager. And if you are in a position where you can confer a benefit, and or you can cause negative job consequences for somebody, if they refuse the sexual favors, then that is called the quid pro quo theory. And both of sexual solicitation by a person in a position of power is protected under the Ontario Human Rights Code. You don't have to expect that. So some of the things that are inappropriate, we've got a little list here. Displaying sexually offensive material, leering, slurs, taunting, inappropriate physical contact. Your supervisor should not or not need to rub your shoulders when he or she gives you work. I've had that one. I've had one where a supervisor made lewd gestures with his tongue on numerous occasions. There's, you know, these are actual things that happen to people in workplaces. So what is bullying? We now have this broader definition under the Occupational Health and Safety Act that includes bullying. And this is really cruel and malicious, humiliating attempts to undermine a specific individual in the workplace or a group of individuals in the workplace. And it's usually unfair, it's usually irrational, and it's very hurtful. It differs from harassment insofar as it is intentional. It isn't a situation where you're going, well, I didn't know. And it includes more than just those grounds that we saw under the Ontario Human Rights Code. Another form of bullying that's not on the slide is cyberbullying. And cyberbullying, again, is when you're using either the office computer or your cell phone or your home phone to bully a staff member, a volunteer, whatever. There are actions that are intended to humiliate and undermine and really destroy an individual. And you know, some examples might be, for example, singling out coworkers in front of others, acting in a condescending manner towards an individual, gossiping, spreading rumors, interrupting, sending hostile emails or other correspondence. And the aim is really to humiliate. What you shouldn't confuse harassment, what harassment is not, because sometimes employees think that the managers don't have the right to assign work, to deal with attendance issues, to deal with performance issues when they arise. Dealing with those issues is not harassment, as is personality conflicts. They're not harassment unless something else has happened. You know, in their busy season, it may be a very stressful time of year, maybe when you're doing your annual general meeting or something like that, where everybody has to put in more hours and everybody's expected to do more. That is not harassment. The exercise of normal management rights, normal management functions, imposing deadlines, setting standards and expectations that we expect people to meet. Now, the only thing is, if those standards and expectations are completely ludicrous and they have no basis in reason, then that might be considered harassing behavior. But normal setting deadlines, setting expectations, you know, changing your job a bit, that's not harassment. Imposing corrective disciplinary measures when people engage in misconduct in the workplace, that is not harassment. Evaluating your work, doing a performance review that maybe you don't agree with, that is not harassment. Asking you why you're late, asking you why you're extending your breaks, asking you why you're on your cell phone for an hour and a half a day talking to whomever, that is not harassment. requesting certification if you're off work for a long period of time, for example, or if you have a pattern of absence, or if you ask for the Friday off before a long weekend and then unfortunately you're sick on the Friday before the long weekend because you couldn't get it off. Asking for a medical certificate in those circumstances, that would not be considered harassment. But what is harassment by managers or supervisor or anyone in a position of authority includes things like a manager humiliates, intimidates, threatens, coerces the employee, excessively criticizes, singles that person out for unequal treatment compared to everybody else, constantly scrutinizing their every move, and using their power over others. And there was a very recent case that just came out from the Ontario Court of Appeal actually this week, and it involves Walmart versus a woman who was working for Walmart as a assistant manager in their Windsor store. And I thought it was really interesting because it was a classic case of abuse of authority where the employer did not take the allegations seriously, paid lip service to this woman's complaints, and actually engaged in very serious misconduct themselves in relation to this individual. She was the assistant manager at this Walmart store in Windsor, and at one point, I guess during the day, they have to take readings of the coolers and they have to record those readings. And her manager came to her and she had recorded a reading that was below or above where it should have been. And he said, I want you to change that reading. And she said, no, I'm not going to change that reading. That's what it was. That's what the temperature said. And he said, you're going to change that reading. Otherwise, we're going to get like a yellow flag and they will get something from Walmart Central in the States that would probably be a demerit point or something like that. And I guess their bonus is based on their production and their efficiency and their meeting all their policies and rules and expectations. So anyhow, she said, no, I'm not going to do it. So then basically he proceeded to make her life a living hell at work. He humiliated her in front of her staff. He would do things like, I was reading in one point, he said, he's in front of like customers and staff member. He goes, can you count to 10? I want you to count to 10. Let's count to 10. Let's see if you can do it. Like that kind of behavior. Anyhow, so she filed a complaint with Walmart and said, I'm being harassed because of this reprisal for not having changed a production report. And Walmart didn't take her seriously at all. In fact, their very cursory, very jaded internal investigation decided that they were false allegations, even though they hadn't even talked to any of the witnesses. And they were going to discipline her for having filed this complaint of harassment against the manager. Anyhow, eventually it just got so bad that the woman had to leave her employment for health reasons. She couldn't work there anymore. She filed what's called a constructive dismissal claim. And at the end of the day, the jury in Windsor was very sympathetic to her, and they awarded her over $1 million in damages. Now, if this were the States, that would be upheld. But this is Canada, and we don't give out those kinds of awards. So Walmart and its team of lawyers appealed to the Ontario Court of Appeal. The decision came out this week. And the good part of the decision is that they upheld the wrongful dismissal. They upheld the damages, 8 months damages for wrongful dismissal for this woman who was clearly constructively dismissed by creating this poisoned work environment that did not allow her to continue her employment. They also upheld the jury's award of damages of $100,000 against the manager, Mr. Pinnock, personally, for inflicting the mental suffering. And they upheld aggravated damages against Walmart to the tune of $200,000. And then they awarded punitive damages against Pinnock. Unfortunately, they reduced it from $150,000 to $10,000. And punitive damages for $1 million against Walmart was reduced to $100,000. So either way, Mr. Pinnock walked out with about $250,000 in damages, and Walmart walked out with about $350,000 in debt, or more actually, when you counter in the 8 months' wages, for not taking this seriously and for basically being being punitive to this complainant for having filed a complaint in good faith. So that's what abusive authority is. And what it's not are things, like I said, counseling sessions, performance appraisals, correcting behavior in the workplace through discipline, or attendance management measures. And the reason we do this is there's really significant cost to employers if you allow harassment and discrimination in your workplace to go untouched. You know, we know that we get more WSIB claims, we get more short-term and long-term disability claims, we get stress claims, reduced productivity, and at the end of the day, reduced efficiency. And certainly we lose very good people, trained people, and you pay money. It's a huge investment to have people that you've trained, and to have them walking out because they're being bullied at work is just not good business. So there's some of the intangible costs. And now we're going to take a look at your policy, which I believe has been in effect since March, and everybody indicated they have read, which is admirable. Key positions of the policy. What you need to know. We're going to talk about all the various parts of the policy, and there they are listed on this slide. And there's a little overview. Why are we doing this? What is the purpose of this policy? We want to prevent harassment in the workplace and discrimination in the workplace. And we want people to know that it's unacceptable, it will not be condoned, and it won't be tolerated in this workplace. So, who does this apply to? This policy applies to everyone. This policy applies from the board of directors, the CEO, senior management, supervisors, all of our employees, all of our volunteers. The expectation is we're all going to be held to the same standard. And it occurs, it applies to all times when you're engaged in EC activities, whether on the premises, off the premises, at business activities, or social events that are sponsored by EC. When does it not apply? It does not apply, for example, if a couple of you get together and go out for lunch, or if some of you join a baseball team together, those sorts of things, because then you're taking it really outside of the employment relationship. Okay, so what's Equine Canada's commitment to you as employees and volunteers? It's we're going to promote a respectful workplace. We're going to promote a workplace where we're not going to have discrimination and harassment, where people are treated fairly regardless of their personal factors. We're going to investigate incidents. If you tell us, if you complain, we're going to investigate. You do not have the right to go to a coworker, to a supervisor, somebody in a position of authority, and say, I want to tell you about this harassing situation at work, but I don't want you to do anything about it. We can't do that. The law does not permit us to do that. Once we become aware of a situation that is harassing discrimination, we have an obligation to act. We have an obligation to safeguard our staff. So there's no such thing as anonymous complaints. Plus, it's not fair to have an anonymous complaint, because then you may say, well, Julie is doing this at work and it's harassing me, but I don't want you to tell her. Well, you've left an impression in the mind of whoever it is that you've made those comments to, and poor Julie hasn't had an opportunity to respond. She hasn't had an opportunity to know what the allegations are and to have an opportunity to tell her side of the story. So we're going to investigate when we're aware of incidents, and we're going to have to take the necessary action to respond to make things right. And we're going to provide support to you in that process. So definition under our policy, engaging in a course of vexatious comment or conduct that against an employer or volunteer in a workplace that is known or ought reasonably to be known to be unwelcome. And please remember that this is the broader definition that we saw in the Occupational Health and Safety Act. It's not tied specifically to the enumerated positions provisions under the Ontario Human Rights Code. And for those of you who may be in other provinces, I neglected to mention at the beginning of this presentation that the law in Canada and the various different provinces is very similar for harassment and discrimination. The violence in the workplace portion is a new provision in Ontario, and it may not apply in all of the provinces. However, it is the standard that Equine Canada expects of all of its employees, and that's why we are rolling this out to all volunteers across the country as well. Okay, some examples of workplace harassment. We've talked about many of these, so I won't go through them, but you can just take a look at that slide. What happens now is, this is the important part. Let's say that you think you're being harassed or discriminated against. How do we bring this complaint forward? What do we do? Well, the first thing we would ask you to do is, prior to filing a formal complaint, talk to the individual. If you feel that you can, and this is not, you absolutely have to, but it would be our preference, that you talk to the individual and say, look, I really don't appreciate when you make those jokes about me being fat, or I really don't like those jokes about whatever. I don't like when you ask me personal questions about my divorce. I don't want you to, you know, give them the opportunity. 9 times out of 10, people will back off. You call them out, you say, look, I really don't appreciate that. Usually that will be the end of it. But if it's not, and or if you feel that you can't have that conversation, then maybe you might want to have that conversation with a supervisor or a manager that can assist you then to have that conversation with the coworker or the volunteer. If you still feel that the situation has not improved, then you can ask for support, obviously, from the senior management, the CEO, and you can file a complaint with the CEO. And your complaint should contain particulars of what's happened, the incidents, the behaviors that you're complaining about. Think of the 5 W's: who, what, when, where, why. Who did it? Give specific names. Give names of witnesses, if there are any witnesses. Often a lot of these things happen in the absence of witnesses, because that's the nature of harassment. But if there are witnesses to events, put them in your complaint. Who, what, when, where, why. What happened? Be particular. I was standing beside the water cooler when Jane Doe came up to me and punched me in the arm. What happened? Where did it happen? When did it happen? Dates. Be as particular as you can in your complaint. The more particular you are, the more credible you are, quite frankly. And that will be the basis for the investigation, is that complaint. That complaint will be shared with the alleged harasser, who we often refer to as the respondent. And the reason that we share that complaint with the respondent is we have to provide what's called procedural fairness. We must be fair. We must give everyone an opportunity to defend themselves equally. So that complaint will be shared, and the individual will be given an opportunity to respond to that complaint. And they might choose to respond to that complaint in writing, or they might choose to respond to that complaint by meeting with the investigator and simply telling their story and having the investigator write that down. So complaints need to be filed within a reasonable period of time. We didn't specify a specific period of time, but the longer you wait to complain about something, the less credible you become. If you file a complaint and say, well, 3 years ago, this happened. If, on the other hand, you say 3 days ago, even 3 weeks ago, then you look more credible. So if you're going to file a complaint, file it in a reasonable period of time. Don't let it fester. Very important part of the process is confidentiality. Only those on a strictly need-to-know basis, need-to-know, should be involved in the complaint. If you are a witness, if you are a complainant, if you are a respondent, we expect all of you to maintain confidentiality with respect to. You're not to be talking to your coworkers. You're not to be talking to your friends about the situation. It's very important that we maintain confidentiality, because people's reputations are at stake here. So if you have a complaint and your complaint happens to be against the CEO, obviously all complaints go to the CEO, except complaints about the CEO. And complaints about the CEO will go to the president of the board of directors. And similarly, if you had a complaint about a member of the board of directors, then that complaint would be filed with the CEO. Any complaints regarding non-employees, volunteers, suppliers, the UPS driver, you know, anyone that comes into your workplace would be made again with the CEO. So we've talked about how you only disclose on a need-to-know basis. There's no anonymity when filing a complaint. You cannot file anonymous complaints. We will not take them. So don't do it. Any questions or concerns about an incident, you're supposed to, under the policy, speak with the CEO. Okay, so let's sort of walk you through what a complaint, what an investigation might look like. First off, once the complaint is filed, we've got all the particulars. We know who, what, when, where, and why happened. We know all the allegations that we're going to be investigating. The CEO, sometimes with the assistance of legal counsel, will decide whether or not this investigation is going to be internal. We're going to have somebody, one of the managers, perhaps, do the investigation. Or are we going to go outside and hire somebody from the outside to do the investigation? And normally when it's just, you know, maybe coworkers against coworkers, you would do an internal investigation. Sometimes when an investigation involves senior management, often they will go outside and hire someone from the outside for, you know, so that there's neutrality. So the CEO is going to assign an investigator to do the investigation, and then the investigator is going to first meet with the complainant because they need to get the story down. And they're going to meet with you either on site or off site at a convenient time, and they're going to take you through your statement that you've made and ask you some questions. And then they're going to meet with the witnesses that you've given them, and then they will meet with the respondent and put all of this to the respondent so that they can have a chance to defend themselves. Everyone will be advised of confidentiality. Do you have an EAP program, employee assistance program, under your benefits plan?
No, we have limited
access. Okay, so in the event that there is a requirement for support, we would provide that through you know, some source, perhaps some counseling if necessary, that sort of thing. At the end of the day, the investigator is going to determine whether or not the allegations are true. Are they substantiated? Are they unsubstantiated? Or they couldn't make a finding. Quite often, these matters come down to credibility. And that's one of the most difficult things to assess, but a good investigator will assess credibility, and they'll determine, you know, whose story makes more sense, whose story rings of truth. Were there any witnesses? Did the witnesses corroborate the complainant's story? Does the timeline make sense? They'll consider all of that. Was the witness forthright? Did they answer all my questions, or did they have a selective memory? They'll assess all of that in determining who's more credible and make findings at the end of the day. And those findings will be prepared in a report that will be provided to the CEO, and the CEO then will make a final decision regarding the investigator's findings. And if the complaint is against a member of the board of directors, then again, it's going to be conducted by an independent third party, and remedial action will be taken from there. And then we're just going to keep these records for a period of 2 years, and it won't be in the employee personnel file, it'll be in a separate file. If any disciplinary action results from the investigation, then that, of course, would be on the appropriate personnel file. So at the end of the day, in terms of the policy, what are the employee and the volunteer's responsibilities? To act respectfully in the workplace, to report incidents when you're aware of them, to comply with the terms of the policy, cooperate with the investigation. You can't say, sorry, I'm not giving you a statement. No, we expect you to cooperate. If you saw something, if you heard something, and you're asked, you're expected to give a statement. Participate in education and training and education such as this, And the employer's responsibilities. Clearly, the employer has the responsibility to train, educate, to model, to ensure that we have a coordinator who's going to coordinate all of this, and to review reports and to facilitate support as necessary. So what happens if you violate this policy? Well, if you violate this policy and you are an employee of EC, you can be subject to disciplinary action up to and including immediate dismissal from employment, depending on how serious the misconduct is. If you're a volunteer, then you may no longer be a volunteer with EC. And it's not just individuals who violate the policy in that manner. There are other ways that you can be subject to discipline under this policy, and those are managers who are aware of harassment but permitted it to continue. They condone the behavior. They can be disciplined. Employees or volunteers who bring forward complaints in bad faith or for vexatious reasons. In other words, they made it all up. It's untrue. That undermines the policy, and certainly a misuse of EC's resources, because, you know, this is time-intensive work. Employees or volunteers who made false allegations may be subject to dismissal. They may be subject to no longer volunteering for us. So, significant. We will not tolerate reprisals. If you file a complaint in good faith, we will ensure that there will be no reprisals against you for having cooperated in the investigation, for having been a witness in the investigation, and for doing your part. And those that do engage in that type of behavior will be subject to disciplinary action. And so we're going to monitor and review this policy regularly. And the law requires that at least once every 3 years that we do harassment training. So we will be doing that in another 3 years. And everyone has done an acknowledgement and hopefully understands what this is all about.